Welcome to the Richard Art Center. My name is Herb Yekos, the Executive Director of the Art Center, and we are pleased and honored to have this opportunity to exhibit for decades the extraordinary body of work by Bay Area artist Mildred Howard. This is her first solo exhibition at Richmond Art Center, and she had recognized that if any place she would like to have a solo show, here in Richmond was her preferred location. Today, we have also a wonderful opportunity to have the artist herself, Mildred, to talk about her voice and vision, and discussing how her work evolved over the past four decades. And also, I want to recognize the sponsors of the exhibition, which would not make this exhibition any company catalog that I have in my hand possible. And that is the J. DeVille Trust, as well as all of our companies here in Richmond, for supporting the exhibition.
No, but I think this is just such a wonderful, unique experience here to be able to be with your work and talk to you about it. I know you're incredibly generous with your time and your insights into art and into our culture. I would like to start by talking about the earliest piece that we have here, which is Last Train from Dixie and the $1.25, which dates from 1978. And this is a rather small piece, which you might have seen as you first came into the exhibition, but it has all of the elements that we see in Mildred's work throughout the decades that followed. Elements such as mining family photographs, collaging different materials, stitching by hand so that the stitch and the thread make a mark just as important as the drawn element would be in a work. And handwriting, making your own mark with your own hand. And I was wondering if you could please talk a little bit about this early work and how you brought all these elements together in the very beginning.
I come from a family of storytellers, great storytellers. And I remember my parents talking about their move from Galveston, Texas to San Francisco. And so those pieces trace that whole history. One day I was on Rose, and then it was before it was Martin Luther King, it was Rose Street. And there was an antique shop right there on the east side of the street. And they had these savings bonds, envelopes, and pages from that stamp collectors use when they collect stamps. And I became interested. I said, well, what can I do? I'm always trying to figure out what can I do with material that's already around because it has a history. And at the time, I was working at a place called Fiberworks Center for the Textile Arts. And there was an exhibition coming up. And I don't care how much I plan in advance, I'm still always working up to the very last minute with things going out the door and me working on them, even if I've shown them before. And so when I got these pieces, oftentimes materials dictate what we're going to do. And so the materials were like turning back fragments of history. And so it evoked all these memories of this migration, one of the migrations of African Americans from the South to this area where my family ended up living. They moved to San Francisco. They worked both in Richmond and in San Francisco at the shipyards. They were like many people who came during that time. So that work is very much about that. At the time I had just finished a course in pattern making and design. And so I ran out of glue, so what do you do? You sew it on the sewing machine. And that's how I got into doing that work.
Well, I think that's really exciting how we introduce new elements, sometimes out of despair, because something is not working or we've run out of materials. And this is totally jumping into a direction as an artist thinking about this. But we see in history that very often, mostly, that artists are always reacting to something, that something that they've seen, the way in which work has been done, has led to a change in work. And I think it's really fascinating that you have moved from one material, one medium, to the next, and on. And I'd like to know just how you keep and how you kept that fire going for all these years in approaching your work.
I guess it's because I'm curious. I'm curious about the world in which we live and how one interprets things as they see them. But I'm going to read something, and it's probably off the subject, but I'm going to read it anyway. And it's the allegory of the cave, and it's Socrates. Imagine this, people live under the earth in a cave-like dwelling, stretching a long way up toward daylight. It's this entrance toward which the entire cave is gathered. The people have been in this dwelling since childhood, shackled by the legs and neck. Thus, they stay in the same place so that there is only one thing for them to look at, whatever they encounter in front of their faces. But because they are shackled, they aren't able to turn their heads around. So, Socrates, some light, of course, is allowed them, namely from a fire that casts its glow toward them from behind them. Being above and at some distance, between the fire and those who are shackled, i.e. behind their backs, there runs a walkway at a certain height. Imagine that a low wall has been built, the length of the walkway, like the low curtain that puppeteers put up over which they show their puppets. Socrates, so now, imagine that all along this low wall, people are carrying all sorts of things that reach up higher than the wall, statues and other carvings made of some stone or wood, and many other artifacts that people have made. As you would expect, some are talking to each other as they walk along, and some are silent. This is an unusual picture that you are presenting here, and these are unusual prisoners. They are very much like humans. And the reason why I read that is that I think that oftentimes what we see is right in front of us. It's right there. You just have to take advantage of it. And so moving from one thing to the other seems only natural. I mean, it is there. What all we need to know about anything is right there. What all we need to know about this picture with this water, it's right there. The information is there. You just have to be curious enough to seek it.
I know that that literature has been important for you. And I think a lot of people are very captivated by the safe house here in this exhibition and by the memory garden that's in the other gallery. I think it would be wonderful to have a little insight into the things that have really grabbed you and moved you when you've read them, and how you've been able to make transitions from literature into processing life and finding a physical form for some of these ideas and themes.
Well, I guess I used to think I was weird when I was really young, but then I realized I was really pretty normal. But I see things in images. I don't think it's a really big deal. It's just the way I'm wired. And in terms of Memory Garden, which is, I think I did that in late 80s, early 90s, that was based on a book that I read in the eighth grade, and that was the autobiography. biography of an ex-colored man by James Weldon Johnson. And it goes back again to the stories that I heard growing up. And James Weldon Johnson, if you're not familiar, was the ambassador to Nicaragua in the late 1800s. But also he was a great, great writer. And in this book, there was a passage that where he talked about there were bottles that grew in there that he went to visit a relative. And this relative lived, the house was set way back from this road. And in the front yard were very colored, and if some of you I know have heard this before, but they were very colored glass bottles and stuck in the ground and nipped down. And he wondered if the bottles grew as the flowers grew, or the bottles grew as the flowers did, and proceeded to dig them up. Now, anyone that comes from New Orleans or Alabama or Mississippi or anywhere in the South, no, you cannot dig the bottles up because they're put there to keep the bad spirits away. And as a result, he got this terrific spanking, he said, that fixed the memory in his mind. And so the next day, I'm thinking, okay, I'll do a bottle house. And this whole investigation or inquiry into this, it opened up all these other avenues. There are bottle trees. When I did my first bottle house at the Edwin Center for the Arts in 1990, I found out that also bottles, empty bottles are dead soldiers, but how appropriate for doing something in an old army barracks. But I didn't know that until then. So that's how. And in terms of safe house, I think I read something in the paper about something that happened, the violence against women. And I was just so appalled by this. And Lizetta LaFall-Collins was curating one of the inaugural exhibitions at the Museum of the African Diaspora. And so I came up with this, but originally this was supposed to be a matrix, but because the ceiling, where I was going to suspend knives from the ceiling, that created this matrix, this house. Mm. But it couldn't, the ceiling was too low, the budget was too small. And so I had to come up with something. And that's when I decided just to do the frame and to cover it with dinner knives that you might hear fall. But, and so at the same time, I was talking with a friend about covering the floor with these objects. Because oftentimes I've read where most of the violence happens right there in the home, whether it's the violence against seniors, against women, against men, against children, it happens in the home. And why do we place such value on things? I mean, they're just things, they're not humans. So I had them go from polished to tarnished. And then the knives on the wall represent a story that I heard about a woman who was attacked, and she threw a butcher knife in the wall. And so that's why I have the knives on the wall.
And when you first started with the house, did you immediately feel that you had something which you could use for so many different expressions and different forms, and that it would become a vehicle for such deep exploration?
Well, you know, the great thing about art is that you're always learning. You're always learning. And for some reason, I knew that it would take 4,000 bottles to do my original house. But I wanted to know what is that number? What does it really look like? And 4,000 bottles would fill up this whole gallery. I do know that. And no, I didn't know that it was going to open up so many avenues, and I didn't realize that I would still be making them. Well, my last one was 2 years ago? Yeah. So I didn't know that it was going to carry me through this far.
I think that there's an interesting connection between the bottle and the bottle warding off evil in the hand. And your hand is always one of protection and also a way of reaching out into the world and experiencing and processing the things that you're encountering. Could you talk a little bit about the beginning of when you started casting your hands?
Which piece are you talking about?
Well, I'm thinking there's several pieces here where you use your hand. You use your hand here for switching in the kitchen, and you use your hand for sanctified testimony. We've also talked about, I was in the Mildred studio and there was something there. It was a wonderful old lunchbox, flat lunchbox. We've all got those that we associate with our childhood. And you said, I'm going to cast my hand holding this, and you know, the hand reaching out and defining and creating.
I mean, my hand is there.
Yeah.
I try to use what I have. In the 70s, my mom was an antique dealer, gave me a set of Billie Holiday 78s. It took me to the 90s for me to use those. And so anyone who's been to my house knows that I cook. And so I can't remember who was on my stereo. I think it was either R&B or jazz. And there was probably a lot of people. And that's when that came to mind. And because when you're dancing, when you're talking, oftentimes people use their hands. So the gestures are different gestures that I sometimes use. So that's how I came up with switching in the kitchen. And I was invited a couple of years ago to Dakar to do something for the U.S. Embassy. And maybe 2 months before that, I had my DNA done and found out that I was from, my tribe is from Senegal and Gabon, part of my tribe. I think it was like, well, a large percentage. Maybe, was it 84 or 90%? But anyway, part of my, I think it was 80%, because 14% is from Scandinavia, 80% from Senegal, Gabon, and the 4% is Asian, and usually Asian is Native American. I said, oh shit, only 4%, if it were 8%, I could collect some money. But I found it really interesting because of when you have experienced or studied about music, the music of African Americans in this country, you talk about that journey and how things have transpired from Africa or West Africa to the quote new world, and how that has transpired over the years and the connection between the two. So that's how I came with switching in the kitchen from Dakar to Detroit and the Mississippi Delta, and Detroit meaning Detroit, and sanctified testimony. I can't remember that one too much, other than it's similar in some ways to the hands and the movements that happen when I'm in the kitchen.
One of the things that is so amazing with your work is how it's almost like being a time traveler looking at your pieces, that we're looking at things from the deep past, and we're seeing it layered, and we're seeing, for instance, old family photographs, and then your hand in the present holding on to things, and really love to talk a little bit about your millennials and XYZ, because I think those are such extraordinary pieces. They're very recent. And they work so beautifully back and forth between the historic newspapers that you've taken and the images of contemporary youth. You've incorporated popular figures, your nephew, your grandson, and relatives, and integrated them where the past comes through, where the type comes through from the newspaper back and forth. And how did you start with that particular series?
Oftentimes young people think that they discovered something. That's particularly when the hip hop movement came out. A staunch jazz fan said, oh no, it's not gonna last, it's this and that. But it's still here. And the Los Angeles Tribune is the African American Tribune that, I can't be. It's an African American Tribune. Oftentimes that's how people got their news, was through this newspaper. And those two were given to me, my parents, and they were from the 1940s. And on some of them are issues that are dealing with today. I mean, the same thing that happened then is similar to what's happening to today. But I really am intrigued by young people of today. They remind me of the 60s and the 70s. Living here in Berkeley and living in this area, and how they are just doing their own thing and coming up with their own way of looking at the world. But it still comes from a deep, deep history of music. I mean, Mumbles, King Pleasure, Louis Armstrong. There are a number of people who used words like that when they were singing. And so I wanted to juxtapose these icons who have made so much money and young people who support them. So I would juxtapose Andre 2000 with my grandson, or with one of my students who's recently come to the United States from China. And I put all of these young people together because I think, I really truly believe, just from my experience in working with them, they, at least the ones in this area, have a whole other way of looking at the world. They are not tripping off the same stuff that my generation did. And it's really a breath of fresh air when you talk with them about life and about how they see the world. The world is changing. It's not going to be the way, it's not going to be business as usual. So there are those two pieces which are up there on the left there, Chingolay, and Chingolay is really similar to Chingolay and Lithos. But it's really similar to collage. It's just you run it through a press.
One of the other pieces that isn't here but from that series had, because I was reading the paper, and there was Louis Lomax, and I'm from LA, so he was huge in my childhood, my growing up. And I think that's really true, that there is this connection between the 60s and the idea. I mean, I think everyone felt that the world was going to be a very different place and changing. And I think what we're watching is change and incorporation often. But one of the things that comes through with your work is this layering and an aggregation of materials and large numbers, repetition of the objects. I sometimes feel like the large number really is so strong, and you get the power of the number and the multitude. And then also there's the power of the single.
two together, and that some of the haunting and very powerful. And what comes to mind for me is your flying low with, if you've seen the piece out in the West Gallery, it is a cast of a work glove with two small birds in it. And it is a very a quiet piece for me. I found it haunting. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how it feels for you moving back and forth between the very large, the very huge, the numerous, and then the very quiet and small.
Actually, it's all the same thing. It's just making art. Whether I fill this room with, you know, ceramic eggs on the floor, or do the birds, it's all the same thing. But I was thinking more about, I mean, doing installation or assemblage or collage or drawings or printmaking, you still deal with the same formal aspects of making art. I mean, they're there. But I want to read something, because or else I'll get bored. This was, hearing myself, this is a poem that was written when I was in Bellagio. I was at the Rockefeller Foundation, and the piece with the buttons, I did several like that, was based on that. And I met a poet named Mary Jo Bang, and we would sit in this, the Rockefeller Foundation in Bellagio is this beautiful mansion, which is about a mile from the road. And when you go there, this gate opens up and you go this winding road through orchards, olive trees and vineyards. When I first went there, I'm thinking, okay, they're taking me through here to go to another place. And then when I got there, I said, damn, I'm here. I couldn't believe it. But Mary Jo Bang, who teaches in Kansas City, wrote this poem because we would sit in the music room and listen to Abby Lincoln and talk about art. The world is falling down, and in where the windows bend, where the sky is the color of a day, that's overtaken and down in the dam that stays, is a record of when the sky was the color we wanted it to be. Don't ever say we didn't see it. It's no more, the dark. Door frame opens into the beige room. The blood red floor comes up to meet the board that makes a mockery of a boundary. This is how you are, different than, different from all the other differences. You are darling, you are. Just yourself and just so. Where the window was is sky now. The Magritte blue you believe in. A song from another country. A button, painted shell. Night is as good as day. I say it's better, like death. Only better because there is that sky. Dante faints at the end of Act 3 and 5. It's sometimes too much. This going on, I'm telling you. There are only a few windows left. The others have become stakes in the heart of believing in tomorrow. Remember Joan, who burned for simply being? She's our girl in hell. That's the place we'd rather be. We'd rather be you and me. Please hold my hand. That was a poem by Mary Jo Bang. And at the end, it reminds me of what's that, when all the musicians are in hell, the name of that play? And it's the oldest, from the 1930s or 40s, the black play that was everywhere. Was it Tambourine Story, or was it, it wasn't Morgan and Bess. But at the end, they're all dancing and having a good time.
So when you see objects, when you encounter them, when you are, when they engage you and they speak to you, sometimes they sit in your studio until you use them. You said sometimes you have them for a long time, and sometimes they just scream at you and you know exactly what to do with them and you're gonna pick them up. And there's also this imbalance in weights that you're working out when you're putting these elements together. Do you know exactly how you're gonna, you know, deal with these objects sometimes?
Some things I know, but some things evolve in the process of making. You have this idea in your head and you just want to do that. But you have to let the material and the work speak to you. You become a part of it. It's interesting because if you don't, it goes back to being curious and being interested in the art of making. And so, yes, I may have something in mind, but it just might not work. But even when I do things, I still question it. And I think that is an underlying factor that I'm always questioning what I do. It's, you know, like, it could have been really good. And so I have that's always in my head.
I think Perch is an extraordinary piece. We had to move it because we had to make room so we could all sit here together. But Perch is so interesting in that it has elements that are an imbalance in terms of size and weight and presence. But they work back and forth because the smaller has much more detail and is much finer and it's representation of the crow and all these elements. And then you have this huge globe perched on the top of your turn piece. And could you talk a little bit about
where's the piece?
It's back there. Okay. I had to move it back there.
When I did that piece, if you think about what's happening right now in this country, in terms of the injustice against people of color, particularly African-American boys and young men. And it wasn't that long ago since Jim Crow was around. So the crow is a metaphor for so many different things. And when you look at the globe, all these borders are made up. I mean, they really are. They're made up. We shouldn't even have to deal with that. We should be able to move freely anywhere we want to. But it goes back to that whole thing of control and divide and conquer that we've all read about and heard about. But in doing that piece, all of those things came up, and then I always thought the crow was a super clean man. I mean, here he is with his cane. So no matter what others thought about it, you have to think about, how do I see it? How do you see it? I mean, that's what's important. You have to really think for yourself because the world is so twisted. It is really twisted.
So there's music, there's art, there's food, there's literature, there's history and politics, and it seems I watch you sort of bringing it all together and then refining what it is that you put in your work. And I wonder from your point of view how you balance all of that. Is it something that you're not... I also see Duchamp in your work and Matisse in your work, and so that there's just this huge salad, and I wonder if you're ever conscious of refining those.
Well, yeah, for example, Skillet to the Frying Pan in Black. That was very much inspired by Duchamp's The Wheel. What was that piece called?
Bicycle Wheel.
The Bicycle Wheel in the stool. yes, I'm very, art is a discipline. You study it, I read, I go to museums, I look at other artists' work, artists who came before me. This is nothing new that I'm doing, it's just maybe I'm doing it a little differently. But I do study and I do read, I go to as many shows as possible, I travel, and all of that inspires and informs what I do as an artist. Thank you for asking that.
The other day you said two things about your mom. They're close. I mean, we were talking for 2 minutes and you started talking about your mother. Mm-hmm. And the first one thing you said that I just heard you re-say, which was, you've got to think for yourself. That was, you said that that was what she taught you. And that another thing about when you were talking about redoing the floors from Anna Head School, she said to you, if you're going to do something, do it right. And I wonder whether or not the fact that, you know, that challenge to do something right, it, you know, it's, I think in artists, it causes this perfectionistic sort of impulse. And yet you somehow allow yourself the accidental, which is the right to fail, the right to...
But sometimes the failure is the right. So you, I mean, some of my biggest mistakes came out of things that I thought that wouldn't work. And one example is, well, not that particular one, Alabama, World War II. I had a stack of windows from a piece that I did in Marin County. I had it for a while. And I was going to throw them away after I did the installation. And I had a half tone that I dropped just because there was nowhere else to go on top of the window. And that's how that idea came. But the ripping and the tearing of papers, the stitching them, are all just out of trying to figure out other ways of doing and other ways of seeing. And the quote that you are talking about, and she was, when I was 15, there was a school being torn down in Berkeley called Anna Head, which is now Anna Boys. And so the story was that my mom said, well, they're going to throw away all these old floors and Philippine mahogany wood paneling. We should go get it. So that summer, I spent the summer with her tearing the flooring up, like similar to this, but I think these are maple floors, but tearing the flooring up, taking out all the nails and reinstalling them in our house. And countersinking every single nail and sanding the floor. But it was the best summer because it reminded me of the painting of the, yes, yeah, it reminded me of the painting, and it also showed me what you can do with what's already here.
Maybe I've been looking at this big house here and I wanted a couple of questions. What made you decide to do this? And the glitter is essential to this. The object just glitter. And I think what is important to it, would you talk a little bit about this large installation?
Well, one of the things is that when I was doing this, I also found out, and going around to antique shops and eBay and flea markets to buy all the silver, I also found out that those who made these kinds of objects at one time also made shackles that shackled African Americans when they were brought to this country. And it goes back to me talking about how we place importance. I mean, I like silver, but I like people better. How do we come up with making this more important than people? People have these things in their houses and they never use them. use of. And so it's that ongoing question about how we place value on certain things and how they can oftentimes become more important than the people who own them. So that's why I did that. And again, it goes from polished to tarnished.
The thing about your work that strikes me most is its political aspects. That's what attracts me to it. And when you think about a piece, I know you talk a lot about being an artist and what that entails, and I give full credit to all of your research and your work. But isn't the core of what you're doing political? Isn't that where you start?
But oftentimes things that happen really impact, I mean, I have a deep feeling for things that happen. The Bullets on the Wall is from a 1989 piece that I received the Adeline Kim Award for. And when I first heard about that, thought about that, was in the 70s when the South African, there were South African students who wanted to learn English as opposed to Afrikaans. And some of them were shot. I mean, and it goes back to this whole thing about borders, about control. I mean, it's just ridiculous. You want to learn to speak a different language and you get, it's like Bush talking stupid about the only language is English. I mean, come on. You go to, you travel to Europe or other parts of the world, and there are young people who go from one language to another. From one language to another. And it's ridiculous. And then to be killed because you want to speak a different language. So I guess in that sense, if my story comes across as being political in the work that I do, then I guess that's what it is. But if you guys haven't seen, there's a piece on the Richmond BART that I did for Richmond, and on the BART parking garage. Somebody forgot to turn off their phone. But anyway, I work with Ishmael Reed on that. And so I'm just going to close, and if you have a chance, it's on both sides of the parking structure. You can go see it. But I think it talks about Richmond and sort of the history. We work with Project Reed, which is a literacy group, Ishmael and I. And the poem was inspired from what the information we got from that. So it's called Moving Richmond. By foot, hooves, cycles, rails, wings, wheels on chairs by BART. Moving Richmond, they move their feet to the beat of Jimmy Reed, the costume feet of Cinco de Mayo. They move their forks to peach cobbler at the Blue Moon, the dim sum and the Golden Palace. Moving Richmond, like the ceaseless dipping of the cranes of Port Richmond, like the skidding boats at Point Richmond. Moving Richmond, your eyes move to the flicks at the Old Fox Theater. The press gives you a black eye, but you gave the world a big eye. The Hubble telescope, polished and refined in Richmond, through which the world sees the universe. Moving Richmond, like moving Richmond. Thank you.